My castaway this week is an actor of enormous range. He first came to public attention playing the role of confused suburban man in Alan Ayckbourn's comedies. Then he took on such great roles as Lear and Galileo. More recently, he became a household name in Dennis Potter's The Singing Detective on BBC Television, in which he played a crime writer suffering from a deforming illness. Well, in all of this success, he remains a very private man. Recently, he was voted Best Actor for his performance in Arthur Miller's A View from the Bridge, but he didn't turn up to take his prize. Michael Gambon doesn't believe in stardom. Michael, you really do dislike fame, don't you?
Well, I don't know. I do like it, but I would like to remain anonymous as an actor. I know that sounds ridiculous, really, but I'd like just to be a blank page that no one knows anything about. Maybe it's impossible.
And then every time you walk onto the stage, the blank page becomes
the character, yes.
And a great success in that.
I hope, yes, I think so. I mean, I wouldn't like to walk on the stage and people would say, oh, there's the man who collects toy trains or something. Because I don't collect toy trains, but it just distorts people's...
But you're asking in the end for the impossible, aren't you?
Am
because,
I?
Well, you want recognition as a distinguished actor.
Yes.
And therefore you have to accept what goes with that, which is that people want to know about you mm. and what makes you tick.
Well, I've managed to keep away from it up to now. I'll keep trying.
But now you're arriving on this desert island, so you can't remain entirely private.
Yeah.
Presumably, there must be an element of the show-off in you.
Oh, there is, yes. I think that's what acting is, really, showing off, isn't it? Well, in the beginning, when you start acting, it's standing up and showing off, and it then develops, gets more sophisticated the older you get. But it is showing off, yes.
But there'll be nobody on the island to show off to.
Well, I won't be on there long, you know, because I don't like being alone, so I would try to get off.
You will, of course, have the complete works of Shakespeare, so, I mean, you could declaim to your heart's content.
Yes, I'll try and get it right, and I could do a bit of that. Do a bit of Lear, get the bits right that I did wrong at Stratford, so that would be useful.
How have you chosen these 8 records to take with you?
There are 8,000 records I could take, and I've just used a pin, really. And they're just records that remind me of events and places and people and that sort of thing.
OK, so where does the pin land first?
Oh, it lands with Little Richard, Tutti Frutti.
Tutti Frutti by Little Richard. Now, why did you choose that?
Well, I was a teddy boy in the 50s when I was 18. I was an apprentice in an engineering factory and was quite a well-known Ted in the area. And that record would remind me of that period, you know.
With the big crepe-soled shoes
on. And the drape jacket. That was before I discovered amateur dramatics and went quickly into tweeds and flannels. But that was a terrific culture shock, you know.
But you had no professional training as an actor. I mean, are you seriously suggesting that even then you knew you wanted to act?
Well, I must have done, yes. I joined an amateur theatre when I was 17, I think. I don't know why. I was just walking past it, I think. I went in and started painting the scenery in the evening. I then had my electric blue drape suit dyed black. I thought it would be more acceptable, and I was away.
But you were working as an engineer at the time?
Yeah, as an apprentice in a big factory, where we made everything from machine guns to petrol pumps to aeroplanes.
Now, in order to get your first job in the theatre, you lied.
Yes, yes. My first job was with Michael McLearmore in Dublin, and I wrote to him and told him I'd just play the lead in a play in the West End. He didn't question it. He couldn't care less, I don't suppose. That was my first job, playing the second gentleman of Cyprus in Othello in Dublin. And when I first went to Dublin to rehearse it, I flew from London to Dublin, but we were diverted. So I ended up in Cork at 1:30 in the morning, supposed to be in Dublin to start rehearsals the following morning. So I rang Michael McLearmore at home at that time in the morning. I was so green and must have woken him up. So I arrived late the next day with a clip-on bow tie, and the whole company burst out laughing because he'd made an announcement saying that they weren't to worry because the second gentleman of Cyprus delayed. He said last night we should carry on without him. And they all... It was hysterics.
Let's have your second record.
A second record is Olivier, Sir Lawrence, doing a bit of Othello. It is The Cause.
It is The Cause. It is The Cause, my soul. Let me not name it to you, you chaste stars. It is The Cause.
Sir Laurence Olivier speaking lines from Othello, Act 5, Scene 2. It's pretty moving stuff.
Yeah, some stuff, isn't it? I love it.
He, of course, was quite important in this early career of yours.
Yes, well, I was in the first National Theatre Company under him in 63 when it first started carrying a spear, and I had auditioned for him. So he's always been terribly important to me, and I stayed with him for 3.5 years.
But, of course, you weren't getting any big parts there, were you? That's the trouble. You were still the second gentleman and the third spear.
Yes. Well, over the years there, I built up the parts. I got quite good supporting parts towards the end, but in the end I went to him and asked for better parts, and he said he couldn't give them to me, and I should go away into rep, which I did. I went to the Birmingham rep after the National.
And what happened there?
And there I stayed for a year and ended up playing Othello. And I'd just been in his Othello.
So you were in Birmingham in the swinging 60s?
Yes, 67, I think.
Did they swing for you?
No, I don't remember the swinging 60s at all. They were just about hard work. Although I did go nightclubbing a lot after the evening performances.
Shall we have your next record?
Yeah, well, that's that reminds me of Birmingham rep and 60s and going clubbing, and that's... Breaking Down the Walls of Heartache by The Bandwagon.
Hey, okay.
breaking down the walls of heartache by the bandwagon. Michael Gambon, we've heard that you're a bit of a fibber.
Mm.
You're also a bit of a practical joker, aren't
you? Well, no, I'm a great water pistol user. When I'm in the theatre, I always believe I have a loaded water pistol in the wings with me, particularly if I'm in a play with Stephen Moore, who's also a water pistol user. So it's best if we're not in plays together.
You're going to have to tell us, Sammy. What do you do with your water pistol?
Well, we get each other in blackouts, you know.
You're the sort of actor who makes another actor corpse on the stage, right?
Yes, but I don't corpse. I keep a straight face, but I can get other people. Usually.
You're the bully?
Bully, yeah. It's not fair, really, is it?
Do you mess about in rehearsals?
Yes, I think you should. I think you should have fun in rehearsals because doing it's going to be hard enough, and that's part of the process, I think, of exploring and getting to know the other actors and all that.
You mentioned your leer, and you said something about getting right the bits you got wrong, because there are people who say that when you played Lear, you concentrated so hard on helping Anthony Sher with the fool that in the end you were entirely upstaged by him.
Well, I don't know. Maybe, yes. I mean, that rehearsal period was just glorious, I remember. Tony and I were inventive in rehearsals, and we experimented, and he became like a ventriloquist dummy during one. In fact, during the performance, we kept that in. Maybe it went too far that way, I don't know. But I'd like to play it again and have another go.
1969, you got your first big break in television. What was that?
That was the Borderers series, which was the first, I think it was the first BBC Two colour adventure series. And I got that through being spotted at Birmingham Rep. And I played the Juve lead with the big blonde wig and rode across the lowlands of Scotland on my horse for, it was 26-hour-long episodes, like a dream job. And in between each batch of 13, I went away and played Shakespeare in Rep, Coriolanus, Macbeth, parts like that. So they were good years for me.
Wonderful combination.
Yes, yes.
Let's have your next record.
Next record is Peter Pears singing Mistress Mine, accompanied by Julian Bream. I love Peter Pears, the purity of his sound. And I love guitar and lute, so this is a good combination.
Mistress mine, well may you fare. Kind be your thoughts and void of care. Sweet Saint Venus be your speed, that you may in love proceed. Call me and clip and kiss me too. So, 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 so true love should do. Call me and clip and kiss me too. So, 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 so true love should do. In these woods are none but birds. They can speak but silent words. They are pretty harmless things. They will shade us with their wings. Call me and clip and kiss me too. So, 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 so true love should do. Call me and clip and kiss me too. So, 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 so true love should do. Never strive nor make no noise. 'Tis for foolish girls and boys. Every childish thing can say, go to hell now, pray away. Call me and clip and kiss me too. So, 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 so true love should do. Call me and clip and kiss me too. So, 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 so true love should do.
Mistress Mine, set by Thomas Morley and performed by Peter Pears and Julian Bream on the lute. Well, now, Michael Gambon, in 1974, you came together with a lot of other actors whom we now know very well, Felicity Kendall, Penelope yeah. Keith, yeah. Tom Courtney, in one of the great stage successes of the 70s, The Norman Conquests by Alan Ayckbourn.
Yeah.
Again, it must have been very exhausting, but endlessly enjoyable.
Yes, and it changed my life, meeting Alan Ayckbourn. It was all because of Eric Thompson, who's sadly not with us anymore, who I'd met doing a television series, and he was, at that time, just starting to direct plays. And he sent me these three big scripts, three new Ayckbourn plays.
Creator of the Magic Roundabout.
Yes, he was. We did them at Greenwich, and it was a big hit and transfer to the West End. And it was a good time, all that.
And you all got on terribly
yes,
well.
Yes, we did, yes. Penny kept us in order.
Penelope Keith?
Yes.
Is she that strict?
No, she's not really. She pretends to be.
But Alan Ayckbourn, as you've mentioned, has remained a great influence on your life. In fact, it was he who directed A View from the Bridge, which you've just had such a great
yes,
success
yes,
in.
Yes, yes, yes. I mean, my association goes back to the Norman Conquests, and I've just finished this season with him at the National, three plays. So he's always meant success to me. He allows the actor freedom. His rehearsal periods are such fun, and he's not at all dogmatic, or I just love working with him.
Now, while you were doing A View from the Bridge with him, you were also making a film. I mean, how do you manage that?
Well, with difficulty. I this film, Paris by Night, with Charlotte Rampling, I was doing that while at the Aldwych in View from the Bridge, and that's really tough, you know. One or the other tends to suffer in that situation.
Which suffered on the whole?
Well, I hope neither, really. You just have to get your head down and do it.
So you film by day
yeah.
and you're on the stage by night?
Yes.
In two entirely different roles?
Yes, yes. The film was easier, not such a demanding part. But Eddie Carboni is a real pill, you know, and exhausting. So it was a difficult period then.
We shall have another record.
Woman, John Lennon.
Woman, I can hardly express my mixed emotions and my thoughtlessness. After all, I'm forever in your debt.
Woman by John Lennon. Now, why did you choose that?
Oh, I just loved him, and it breaks my heart that he's no longer with us. So I just love his singing, and I planted a tree for him.
What do you mean you planted a tree for him?
Oh, the day he died. Was killed.
What made you do that?
Just the sense of loss. I'm the same age as John Lennon, almost exactly, I think. And I always felt very close, a fan. I just couldn't bear the thought of him going.
And is the tree flourishing?
I haven't seen it for a while, I think so.
Let's move on to, or move back to 1980, which was your huge success at the National.
Yes,
Galileo, in Brecht's yes. Galileo. How do you prepare for a major role like that? Do you live, breathe and eat it, or do you think about it, analyse it?
No, you just you put yourself in the hands of John Dexter, who's a real boss, and you hope for the best, and you learn the lines, and you study the part, and just hope and pray that it works out all right, and bring everything you've got to it. I don't know how you do it.
When you say you don't know how you do it, is that because you don't have any formal technical training? Are you, in the end, a natural actor?
Yes, I suppose I am. I think I have by now had training, because I've trained, I've watched other people and worked a lot, and I've trained myself. I work a lot with my voice in rehearsals, and physically I try to get into parts. I try to add a physical key into the character.
You have this great physical presence on the stage. It does strike one that you think a lot about the movement
of
the character.
Yes, I do, and costume, and how people walk, move. I try to find some sort of key in that way.
So do you do all of that and then open your mouth, having learned the words, and miraculously they come out in character?
Well, no, you just slaver away, you know, for 6 weeks rehearsal, and you try and make each day different, and you try not to bore people. And if you've done one bit howling your head off, then you do the next bit very quietly. And so they're all the cheap, simple rules of acting, and they all come together, I don't know how.
And then comes the first night. Do you love them or do you hate them?
I look forward to it, going on, to doing it in front of the people. It's good. And I always like to be not quite ready by the first night. And then it adds a little bit of extra nerves to the occasion.
Let's have another record.
Oh, well, the next one is Memories of the Alhambra Palace, played by Narciso Yepes.
Thank you.
Memories of the Alhambra by Francisco Tárrega, played by Narciso Yepes. Well, now, Michael Gambon, in January 1986, you began work on the role which has probably brought you a wider audience than any other role you've played, because it was on BBC television. It was the singing detective, Dennis Potter's play. Now, were you approached to play that part, or did you audition for it? What happened?
No, I didn't audition. I mean, I've got away without auditioning for since I started. They sent me the scripts, six massive scripts, and then I had lunch with the director, John Emile, and told him I'd read them. Of course, I hadn't, because there was far too much to read and I didn't understand them. And the next day they offered them to me.
How did you know it was for you then?
Oh, it's just wonderful stuff, you know. I flicked through them. I read all the important bits.
Now, you played the part of this crime writer stricken with this terrible illness, a kind of combination of arthritis and psoriasis, which, of course, is the illness that the writer himself, Dennis Potter, suffers from. Did you have a relationship with him? Did you
talk to him about it? When we had a first read-through, we read through the whole 6 hours of television in one day, you know, sat in the church hall and did a terrible, frightening experience. And Dennis sat opposite me, and I just watched his hands, because they're buckled up. I watched how he moves, and how he holds cups, and how he smokes his cigarette, most importantly. That's all. I never really spoke to him much about the part.
Did he not turn up to rehearsals?
Only when Joanne Wally was on the set.
What do you mean by that?
Well, he didn't turn up a great deal, but he was always very much in evidence when the dancing girls were around.
Now, Joanne Wally, you mentioned, I mean, it was quite nice for you too, because you got massaged in Greece.
Yes, very, very nice. I enjoyed that very much. In fact, when we rehearsed that, I didn't have the makeup on during rehearsals, but what I did do was spray, I sprayed suspender belt and stockings on my legs for the leg greasing scene, which caused some fun.
What did she do? She corpsed.
Yeah.
Ezekiel cried, dry bones, now hear the word of the Lord. Ezekiel connected them, dry bones, now hear the word of the Lord. Oh, when your toe bone connected to your foot bone connected to your heel bone connected to you. Ankle bone connected to you. Leg bone connected to you. Knee bone connected to you. Thigh bone connected to you. Hip bone connected to you. Backbone connected to you. Shoulder bone connected to you. Neck bone connected to you. Head bone, now hear the word of the Lord. Them bones gonna walk around.
Television drama, which, as you say, was hugely long and very complicated.
7 months. Yeah.
But unlike the theatre, I mean, you don't just go on in television and do it. It's all shot in fits and starts and out of order. And,
yeah.
Do you find that difficult? It's not like walking onto a stage, is it? For an evening.
No.
And going on and living through that character.
It's a minute of intense work, that's all. Into a camera.
So it's an entirely different technique.
Oh, yes, I think so. But it's still acting. It's just, you don't have to speak so loud. the singing detective. I'll never get a part like that again on television, I don't suppose. It's a part of a lifetime. But I do like the combination of flicking between the theatre and television, and I've done that for the past 10 years. I've gone to the National and then done a series and then gone back, and I'm very lucky in that respect.
Can we have your seventh record?
My seventh record? Every Day a Little Death, Stephen Sondheim, Little Night Music.
Why do you want that?
Oh, it's such an intelligent love song. That's what I like about Sondheim.
Are you a very romantic person?
Quite, yeah. I'm not going to tell you how much, but it's sung by Mariah Aitken.
All right, we'll hear the music then.
Every day a little death, in the parlor, in the bed, in the curtains, in the silver, in the buttons, in the bread. Every day a little sting, in the heart and in the head. Every move and every breath, and you hardly feel a thing, brings a perfect little death. He smiles sweetly, strokes my hair, says he misses me. I would murder him right there, but first I die. He talks softly of his wars and his horses and his whores. I think love's a dirty business.
So do I.
I miss
Every Day a Little Death from Stephen Sondheim's A Little Night Music, featuring Mariah Aitken and Veronica Page. What is next then in the repertoire of Michael Gambon?
Well, I'm rehearsing now Uncle Vanya, directed by Michael Blakemore, and we open in the West End next month with Jonathan Pryce and Imelda Staunton.
That's is it a part you've always wanted to play?
Yes, it is, yes. People have often said I should play Uncle Vanya, and now it's happened, so I'm delighted, really.
And what do you nurse in your breast as a kind of ultimate goal of the character you want to play?
I'd like to play Othello again. I've been in it so often, it's stuck with me for years. I was in a Michael McLearmore version in Dublin, as I said, years ago. I was in Olivier's. I was in Schofield's. I played Othello at Birmingham, and I'd like to do it again. I must be mad.
It says in Who's Who in the Theatre, under M. Gambon, recreations, colon.
Oh, yes, all lies.
Open quotes.
Yeah.
Flying guitar and collecting heavy industrial plant, close quote. What does that mean?
I used to fly more than I do now. I play the guitar, or I try to. I'd like to, maybe I'd take one to the desert island and get better. And I love machinery.
And you collect things?
Mm. Yes, tucked down in South London, I collect heavy machinery, plant, equipment.
Where do you keep it?
Oh, it's all locked away. I just, I quite like high-precision machinery, and I like Swiss lathes and universal mini machines and things like that. Things that people know nothing about now.
But what do you do with them? I mean, do you just sort of look at them?
Yes, just look at them.
Stroke
them. Get them working. they're quite easy to buy nowadays. You know, British industry is collapsing, so lots of this plants on the market.
I have this
very
image.
Confusing, isn't it?
It is a very confusing image. I have this image of this man who's desperately dedicated to his profession and is absolutely marvellous at it, who goes home and kind of builds a brick wall around himself to cut himself off from it.
Yes.
The acting.
Yes, I do. I do have another life completely. I think it's quite important for me to do that. I get rather fed up with being in the theatre all the time and being with theatre people. So I have a life outside to do with engineers and collectors and, you know.
Entirely non-darling people.
Yes, non-darlings, yes, yes. But I have a change of personality too. So I become less theatrical, you know.
But it's that bit of you that you don't like talking about.
I suppose it is, yes.
We shall have another record.
Well, Beethoven's Seventh.
Thank you. Beethoven's Symphony No. 7, part of the slow movement played by the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Carl Böhm. What's special about that for you, Michael?
Oh, it reminds me of being in the theatre, you know, being on stage. I like to have that music playing on a Walkman, you know, headset underneath a wig. It'd be nice to go on with that in your head, you know, but you never can. You stand there in the wings with, think of music. But it, as soon as you walk on, it goes, because you've got to speak. But that's how I feel sometimes.
Reading what friends and colleagues say about you, and they don't seem to know too much about you either.
No.
They say that you're warm, yeah, and you're compassionate,
yes,
and you're humorous. But I read also that they think, or one of them thought, you had a terrible temper.
Yes, a shocking temper, really, I think. But I've never let go, so it's quite safe.
How do you know it's there, then?
I just feel it.
All right, let's hear what this luxury is then. What is it that I'm not going to allow?
If I was to build a raft or get off this horrible island, I'd need some tools. I mean, I heard David Penhaligon once on this programme ask for high-carbon tool steel in bar and strip form, and he was allowed to take it, so I should be allowed as well, I think.
Yes, but I think the keeper of the island was different then. I mean,
oh,
you're not supposed to have anything that's practical.
Oh. Oh dear. What about my... Could I take my car? If I promise not to sleep in it.
Just to stare at it. As long as it didn't move and couldn't go and you were just going to look at it, you can have it. Is that...
Can I?
Yes.
Oh, good. Oh, thanks.
Right.
Yes.
And which of the eight records are you going to hang on to if seven of them get washed away?
Well, it's a toss-up between Little Richard and Beethoven, I think. And it'll have to be Beethoven.
No, you got that wrong. And it'll have to be Little Richard. And your book, as we said, you've got the Shakespeare, you've got the Bible.
Yeah. Well, I thought of some really heavy, you know, book that I'd never be able to read, like a book on mathematics, you know, philosophy that I couldn't understand and I'd struggle through. But I'm not going to have that. So I'll have The Republican Party Reptile by P.J. O'Rourke.
Why? What is it?
Just makes me laugh. American humour. And it's a paperback. It's very short.
Michael Gambon, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
It's been a great pleasure. Thank you.